Good afternoon. Welcome. Hello. I am so delighted to see so many people here today. My name is Amy Penkin. I'm the coordinator of the Transgender Health Program at OHSU. This is a program that launched about a year ago, and it's been 6 months in the making, I think, of conversations to create an event like this to welcome the community here to learn from Dr. Dugi and learn about our program. So I'm going to go over some logistics. I've said this a few times, but for those of you that are newly in the room, we have single-occupant gender-neutral restrooms on the first floor behind the concierge desk. If you go out either side of these doors, you'll find multi-stall gendered restrooms essentially behind me. And for anyone who needs their parking validated, we will have that available in this room after 4:15. If you're leaving before 4:15 and you need your parking validated, you can go up to the 10th floor to the urology clinic and they will validate your parking for you. For those of you who have come in and did not sign in, it is not a requirement for you to sign into this event. We just like to be able to get a sense of who's here and also try and get a sense of how many of you represent current or prospective patients, which is really what this forum is designed for, and how many of you represent healthcare providers. I will kindly ask that any of you that represent healthcare providers is to respect that this forum is really designed for our patient community today, and to please yield your chair if the room gets full, and please yield your time to those who have questions that they would like to get answered today, because this is for our patient community. We will have a question and answer session after Dr. Dugi's presentation, and we have some of our volunteers who've been passing around index cards. Kindly write your question on the card. We'll be collecting those back, sifting through them. We expect that there will be some duplicates in those questions. We'll gather them together, try and find the most common themes of questions, and then have a session where we can answer as many of those as possible. If you do not get your question answered today, this will not be your last chance. We will have an evaluation form at the end of the session. I'll put them out on the back table, so please pick one up before you go and fill that out for us. You can put your question there. If you are comfortable identifying your name and contact information, one of the two of us will get back to you to answer your question. We'll have the session ends at 4:30 today, but I will be able to linger around for an extra few minutes for anyone who would like to introduce themselves or ask any questions. We're happy to answer what we can today. This session today is being video recorded. The purpose of that is for anyone who couldn't attend here in person that they'll be able to access this information. It'll be posted on our website for the Transgender Health Program. Although I don't know the timing of when we'll post it, I think we're probably it won't be posted today, I'll leave it at that. But check with our website later. We'll have a link that's available to the public for anyone to view. None of you will be in the video recording. It'll be focused just on here on the podium. We also have Christina Wentz from the Oregonian taking some photographs today. Again, this will not be of any of you. It'll be focused on us and the presentation today. I have a couple of thank yous. First, I wanted to thank Travis Wild standing there in the back of the room. He's the administrator for urology who's thrown a ton of support both to the department, to our transgender health program, and to help us with this forum today. So thank you to Travis. And the Transgender Health Program has been fortunate to have a group of volunteers who've been very dedicated to supporting the work of the Transgender Health Program and have been here today helping guide you to this room and handing out the index cards. So I want to thank Jay and Vic and Kareth for being here and helping today. So let me tell you just a quick moment about the Transgender Health Program. We have some flyers that were left out there in the back that give an overview of our program and our mission. Essentially, what we are looking to do is create a more welcoming and inclusive environment at OHSU for everybody, specifically for the transgender community, thinking about the expansion of our services. You can see the list of clinical services available and non-clinical services. A large part of what I do is around policy development, program development, supporting patients and their loved ones around navigating our system and knowing where and how to access care, answering questions, many, 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 many questions about insurance. Probably one of the most popular questions that I get. And I also provide consultation both to clinical providers within the OHS community and outside of the community. And I see a couple of you here who email me questions all the time, and I'm happy to answer those if you've got questions. It's important to us to have partnerships within the community. There are quite a few health providers here that have been good partners for us for referrals. Many of them have chosen to leave their cards and information on the back table, so feel free to check that out. And what else can I say? If you've got questions about our transgender health program, feel free to look at our website. Email me directly. You can email through transhealth@ohsu.edu. I kindly ask you to be patient with my response time. I get an extremely high volume of emails, and I'm looking for more support to get those answered more quickly. But for now, it takes me sometimes 3 to 5 days to get back to an email, which is a more general question. For something of an urgent nature, I will respond more quickly. So Dr. Dugi will give a broad overview today. We're focused today on vaginoplasty surgery. We do hope our transgender health program will do future community forums on other types of clinical services. So stay tuned for our website. And eventually we'll set up some kind of newsletter. We're not ready to do that yet, but we will, so we can get this information out. Our evaluation form today will be asking you about topics you're interested in for future forums. So please take your time with that evaluation so it can inform us of services and programs that we can do for you in the future. I'll make a few notes just about the referral and eligibility process for surgery, and Dr. Dugi will expand on that, and then we'll probably get to more of that during the Q&A session. First, just to make you aware that most of our clinical services at OHSU does align with the standards of care through the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, version 7. We can give you a link for that if you're more interested in reading through that if you're not aware of it, but that's what you can expect for the most part about how our clinical services are functioning here. That being said, insurance is sometimes aligning well with the standards of care, and other times really not at all. So in terms of accessing care for yourself, a lot of it will depend on what your insurance requirements are, and I'm happy to work with you to figure out what those are and figure out how to navigate through those. For this particular service for vaginoplasty, generally speaking, we would be expecting a referral from a primary care provider, that you've been on hormones for 12 months, that not at the time of consultation, certainly by the time of surgery, but not by the time of consultation, you will have at least a plan for how you'll obtain 2 letters of referral from mental health providers, and I'm here as a resource to help figure out how to get those letters and referrals for providers. Another huge question that I get is around electrolysis. Generally speaking, most insurance plans will cover pre-surgical site electrolysis. We've had huge delays within the Medicaid system to get that approved. We've finally gotten the provider codes and specialty codes sorted out from the state, and now it's the opportunity for the electrologist to start enrolling in health plans. It'll take some time to get credentialed, and there are some health plans that are being very proactive right now to fast-track that. Most insurance plans will cover the pre-surgical site electrolysis, as it's considered medically necessary in order to proceed with surgery. We'll answer some questions about that today, about what that looks like, and if you've got specific questions, I'm happy to answer that for you too. Okay. I'm going to defer the time now to Dr. Dugi. I thank you all for being here, and here we go.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you for being here. My name is Daniel Dugi. I'm a urologist here at OHSU, and I'm going to provide a little bit of information that will probably be very familiar to the familiar faces here in the audience who have already met with me and talked in person. I try to cover a lot of what I would want to get across to you and have as a conversation in the hour time that we typically schedule for a consult relating to vaginoplasty. And then there's some other information that's, you know, a little bit new to that presentation, but the handout that I have in the back of the room, I think there should hopefully be enough to go around, will be information that summarizes that, and hopefully you don't have to remember everything we talk about. So I'll go ahead and get started, and if you wouldn't mind just holding questions to the end, we should have plenty of time for questions. So I'm a urologist, and a urologist is a surgical specialist of the reproductive tract, the sexual organs, and the urinary system. So after I did my urology training, I did an additional fellowship in what's called reconstructive urology. This is a relatively new fellowship. It's been developed over the last really 20 years or so, and it focuses mostly on what we consider reconstructive surgery of the genitals. Is that better? Sorry, I can hear myself. So reconstructive urology is a specialty that's developed largely over the last 20 years, and it focuses on reconstructive surgery of the genitals and the urinary system, and particularly in the patients who have penises and external urethras. That's the large part of what I do, and I'll talk a little bit about what my clinical practices and why that is pertinent and why that led me to do what I'm doing. So really, why am I offering gender surgery? And this came about as I saw patients who were referred to me because they had had complications of surgery elsewhere, or they were seeking orchiectomy, or they were wondering where they could get gender-affirming surgery. And I had other people ask me, and I asked myself, well, why aren't we providing that? Why am I not doing that? That's all the stuff that is in my specialties, the anatomy and the surgical techniques that I know. Why not? Why should I not do that? And it's a need in our community. And I really wanted to help meet that need out of seeing people having to travel so far for surgery, having complications from having surgery from people who don't have the same training and don't have the same, fundamental understanding of the anatomy that's important. Really, it's a desire to meet a need in our community. And in medicine, a lot of times what any one person does, if you don't do it, somebody else will fill that need. And I feel like this is an area where I really could do something that wasn't being done. It was a need that wasn't being met. And that was, from a personal side, that's something that appealed to me, wanting to do something I thought was good for a group of people that, aren't served very well, honestly. So why did I think that my surgical practice is useful for that? So I'll give you an example of the things that are the biggest part of my practice. And I realized as I learned about vaginoplasty that there's really very few, if any, parts of the surgery that I don't already do in other surgeries that I do routinely. So probably about half of my practice or more is what's called urethral reconstruction. So the urethra is the urine tube, takes urine from the bladder out from the body, and it's not a super common problem, but it's common enough that you need a specialist in this, where you have a blockage of the urinary tube and you need surgery to fix that. And the urethra is a fairly delicate organ, and if you don't treat it nicely and handle it properly, you can cause more problems than you solve. You need certain reconstructive techniques like skin grafts and skin flaps to do the reconstruction. And it's something that most urologists are not trained well to do, so that's why there's an additional training and fellowship for that. It's also operating in the part of the body that's very pertinent. So we do this surgery in either the urethra that's on the penis or the urethra that's in what's called the area of the perineum. The perineum is that space back behind the scrotum. There's a few colloquial terms for that, but I'll stick to the anatomic terms and call it the perineum. So that's the area that we're going to be working to create the vagina, and that's an area that I already operate on several times a week. I also do surgery for incontinence in the genetic male. Typically, that's after prostate cancer surgery, and that's important because it's in the same area, but more importantly than that, it's understanding the function of the urinary system and the control of continence that makes this relevant, because you're going to be challenging that anatomy and that set of muscles when you make the changes for the vaginoplasty. I do surgery for something called Peyronie's disease, and it's really better known as just penile curvature. And that can happen in people with penises where you have scar tissue that forms on usually the top side of the penis as you look down. And that's pertinent because the nerves that supply the sensation for the head of the penis, as well as the blood supply, run on top of that area. So to fix the curvature, you have to be able to move those nerves safely out of the scar tissue and then work on the scar tissue underneath it. And that's something that I already do on a routine basis. That step is very important in making the clitoris and the vaginoplasty. You need to know where those nerves are and know how to protect them. And the surgery that I do for curvature is actually more difficult because the nerves are often trapped in scar tissue. And I have a good record and very good experience in doing that safely for people. So I think that that's a natural progression for me. Also, repair of something called a rectourethral fistula. And this is fortunately a rare problem, but this is a problem that happens often after prostate cancer surgery where there's an abnormal connection between the rectum and the urethra. And that's important here because, to get into that space where that problem is the same dissection that you do when you're making the space for the vagina. So separating the space between the rectum and the urethra and the bladder, that's often considered one of the more anxiety-provoking parts of the surgery, because if you damage the rectum, it can cause a problem like a different fistula. And I already do surgery to fix it in more difficult circumstances when people have had surgery in that area, infections in that area, or radiation. So I'm looking forward to doing surgery where people haven't had all those problems. It'll make it easier. And then other parts of my practice are just complex genital reconstruction. So particularly after genital trauma, whether it's gunshots or knife wounds or blunt trauma, the rare patient that has a penis amputation and would like to have it replaced, I'm the person that receives the transfers and takes care of those. We had one of those earlier this week, and so far it's been a success. So I have my point is I get the I understand the anatomy and the techniques that are needed to do the surgery. So I already do a lot of the techniques and steps of vaginoplasty, but it's still a new surgery to me. So how do you learn something new? How does a surgeon learn something new? This is not specific to this surgery or transgender surgery. It's something that every surgeon who comes out of training has to understand, that nobody does exactly what they did when they finished their training. You have to continue to learn and evolve. And how does someone learn new techniques? It may not surprise you to know that there's not a good established pathway for learning this type of surgery in the United States. You know, there's a lot of different reasons for that. I have my own opinions about that, but regardless, not very many people that are considered experts in this field in the United States are really open to teaching new people. And you know, when I started looking at how I could learn, I started like you do with really anything that you want to learn more, you hit the books. You go to the library, you look at medical journals. We, fortunately, through a medical center, you have access to worldwide medical journals. And I've looked at and read literally hundreds of articles related to gender surgery, gender care, transition care, and related things like surgeries that are similar, like certain types of prostatectomy, repair of rectal urethral fistula, all the things that I mentioned before, to learn more about the anatomy, learn more about surgical techniques that are applicable. And also started going to meetings. Went to a WPATH subsection meeting in Europe and started working my connections to get in touch with people that are considered experts in gender surgery, and starting making connections for how to go and learn from those experts. So also, you know, a big part of that is training. I spent 6 weeks over the last year outside of my practice going to places, including two trips to Europe, to learn from experts in the field. This was a wonderful experience for me. I got to meet new colleagues. I went to Serbia for 2 weeks and got to see some sites. Also went to Belgium for 2 weeks. And you may recognize, some of you may recognize this person with me here. That's my wife. She's a plastic surgeon. She also does top surgery. So that's another benefit of going on these trips together, is that we both get to learn something something useful for us, and you know, have some Belgian beer too. So that was nice. Then also practice in the lab. So I've been at OHSU for since 2009, and I'm not a new surgeon. I've been working full-time practice ever since then, but you're always learning new things, and you don't want to try something out that's completely new for the first time in a person. I have too much respect for individuals to do that. So I've been using some of the resources we have at OHSU, which is a wonderful surgical simulation and anatomy lab. And OHSU has been very supportive, as well as our Department of Urology has been very supportive in the resources that are necessary for that. And I've done multiple practice surgeries in donor tissue, so people that donated their bodies to science, in doing cadaveric surgery essentially. So I've done multiple of those surgeries in practice, and I have several more scheduled. And that's been a very interesting experience. Obviously, it's very different from surgery in a live person, but it's actually more difficult in a lot of ways. But it's a good way to get practice without anyone having risk of you doing something for what might be considered the first time. This isn't directly related to my experience, but I think it demonstrates a little bit about my interest. So I'm a cis male. I don't have family members that I know of that are trans, but I'm interested because I've seen a need in our community, and I'm compassionate, honestly. Seeing a need for improvement in transgender care, I was one of the co-founders for our transgender health program in 2012 and have been working on this since then. This is not an effort that's new to me in the last year, although you may have only heard of it in my name in this for the last year or so. I'm trying to be involved with education within OHSU and outside OHSU. I've been involved with helping to teach some of our nursing staff on the ward about what to expect when we're doing surgery, as well as being involved with the Family Care Forum and a couple other events, as well as a upcoming Grand Rounds with OHSU. And I've been honored to participate with Transactive as a advisor on their medical advisory board recently, so I'm very, very excited about that. So that's enough about me, finally. I'm going to talk a little bit about vaginoplasty, give a little bit of an overview first, and we'll go into some more specifics. So just talking about the goals of surgery, you know, there's a lot of goals and a lot of things, but, you know, just trying to, you know, keep this in broad strokes first. So obviously a goal is removal of the penis, the testicles, and the scrotum, and the creation of natural-appearing external female genitalia, a sensate clitoris that is sensitive and available for sexual response, and in most cases, a vagina for receptive intercourse. Now, there's I understand that not everybody wants that, and people are often very sure that they don't want that, and when that's the case, I think that's a good thing to talk about on an individual basis. I don't know if we'll get into a great amount of detail after that today, but that is something that I've thought about and we'll talk about with people on an individual basis. Importantly, this surgery does not remove the prostate. So, you know, the prostate, we don't think that there's a high risk of prostate cancer when people remove testosterone and start taking estrogen, but there's very little medical research about that, and there are no good guidelines or guidance on how to deal with that. But it's important to know that it's still there. Hopefully we will learn more. As you may be aware, prostate cancer is an extremely controversial topic anyway, and, you know, we know even less about it when people are going from having testosterone to having estrogen for a long time. One thing to talk about is, and most people have already thought about this, the consequences of removing testicles. So there's obviously the benefit of removing the hormone that is not part of you know, who you are, and replacing that, but there's some potential things to think about as well. And usually most people think about this before starting the hormones, but you have the loss of fertility. And as you know, when you start, you know, suppressing testosterone and replace it with estrogen, that definitely suppresses sperm production. It's usually not irreversible, and you have the possibility of stopping the estrogen for a period of time and seeing if sperm production recovers, with the possibility of sperm banking or sperm freezing. I have one patient I've seen who took a holiday off estrogen for 6 months and was able to parent a biologic child and then restarted. I understand that's not a popular idea, and that sounds pretty stressful for most people to, you know, to drastically change your hormones, but it's something that everybody should think about before the irreversible step of removing the testicles. Another thing is just, you know, we know that going from testosterone to estrogen, you will have lower bone density, and that's a part of being a female, is that you have the effects of testosterone is gone. The effects of estrogen mean that you have a greater risk of osteoporosis or thinning of the bones. In the rare circumstance where people are not able to take estrogen, often because of blood clots, and if your doctor advises that you're at high risk for forming more blood clots, there have been times where I've seen people who weren't able to take estrogen for a period of time. If that's the case, aside from the distress that would cause, it would also mean that you have much greater risk of having significant bone loss during that time. It doesn't mean that it's something that should hold you back, but it's just something to be aware of. So talking a little more about the techniques in vaginoplasty, I'm going to focus mostly on what I plan as a version of penile inversion vaginoplasty, with the use of the penis, the skin of the scrotum, and the skin of the perineum, that space behind the scrotum, to create a vagina, a clitoris, and a vulva, the vulva being the anatomic term for the external female genitalia. Sigmoid vaginoplasty, or using part of the large intestine for the vagina, is generally most commonly used as what's called a salvage surgery. If the first vaginoplasty does not work and the vagina narrows and stenosis and is unhealthy, that's a revision surgery. I won't talk about that any further today, but that is something that is less common for sure. So what will become the new parts? What's going to be used to be the new organs? So the head or the glands, penis, will be used to make the clitoris, and the nerves that supply the sensation are very carefully removed from the underlying penis and kept intact along with the blood supply. The skin of the penis itself will be what we call inverted, so turned, you know, outside in, and used to be at least the lining of the beginning of the entrance of the vagina, as well as the inner labia or the labia minora, and the clitoral hood or the covering of the hood of the clitoris. The urethra will be repositioned so that it comes out, you know, the urine comes straight from where it comes out of the bladder. That position may not be as directly down as genetic females, but we will make it as close to directly down as possible. Some of that tissue will also be used to line the space between the opening to the urethra and the clitor, so there's a natural pink mucosal surface there. It may also be used to make some of the inner labia. The skin from the scrotum and the perineum will be used to make the outer labia, and also extra skin from that area will be used to line the vagina. On occasion, if people don't have enough skin, either from the penis or from the scrotum, additional skin may be needed to line the full space of the vagina. That can be taken from the lower abdomen or even the groin, kind of depends on your case and how you're built and put together, and where there's more or less hair or where there's more or less skin. I think that's pretty uncommon, but it's one of those things that it's an option and a possibility. So I don't have any scary surgical pictures or anything, but there are some anatomic diagrams just to kind of show the areas that we're talking about. So this is a look through the pelvis from the side, and you see that there's not really any space for a vagina. That space is created here, and it's under the urethra, between the urethra and the rectum. So this is a little cartoon, and you'd be surprised, there's very few diagrams and drawings of the steps of the surgery that aren't surgical pictures. This is something from the early 90s, and really the best diagrams that I found. And it shows that the skin of the penis is separated from the rest of it. So it's important to know the details of the anatomy are, because the skin of the penis, the glands or the head of the penis, and the deep structures of the penis all have separate blood supply. So you can take them apart and move them different places, and they will survive on their own without really much problem. So you can separate the glands, the head of the penis, from the skin and use that skin in a different way. And here you see the sleeve of the skin separated from the deep structures. And here this arrow is showing the area of the urethra, the urine tube. It'll be shortened. And then once everything is turned inside out, that area of the Y there is the space for the new opening to the urethra and will be the place where the new clitoris goes. There on the bottom is showing, in this diagram, they've closed the end of the skin on the penis to be the end of the vagina. And with the technique that I plan to offer, that will be extended by skin from the scrotum used as a graft. Now, a graft refers to tissue that you disconnect from its blood supply, you remove the extra tissue, and you put it up against a raw surface in the body. New blood vessels grow in over time. And that's important because that is a kind of a delicate process. And it's really important, especially in the first 5 to 7 days, that there not be much movement of that new skin, because it could disrupt the new blood vessels that are growing in. And that'll come into play when we talk about, after surgery recovery and why you end up being in the hospital as long as you do. So this is just showing that we plan to use an extension and to lengthen the amount of skin that's used on the inside. So it's not just limited to the length of the skin of the penis. People often ask, do I have enough skin? Even if there's not enough skin from the penis, and few people have enough length of skin of the penis to line that whole space, we use skin from the scrotum and other skin if necessary to do the job. And then once all that's in place, turned inside out, and then sewn in place. Now, this diagram shows something that's important, in that before the early to mid 90s, there's not really much effort to make a clitoris. And the first efforts at making a clitoris, when I review the medical literature, were shockingly not very thoughtful, I didn't think. I mean, they were using various different things that made a little lump, but we have this sensate structure, we have the nerves, why not use that? And eventually that was used, and that's pretty standard today, but that wasn't something that was done commonly until the early 90s. And this diagram here from that time doesn't show that there's a clitoris in place, but obviously that's something that we would plan to do. Another thing that's important about this diagram is showing that you can see the mouse moving? Okay, so this suture line here, which represents kind of the middle of the outer labia or the labia majora, that shows that these do not come together over the clitoris as the labia do in genetic women. And that's one reason why there's often been discussion of a one-stage or two-stage vaginoplasty, and we'll get to that a little bit later. But this diagram is showing that feature a little bit more. So again, talking about the clitoris, this is a view from the top of the penis once the skin is removed, showing all the important structures, the nerves, the vein, and the arteries that supply the head of the penis. Those are all kind of together in one broad section. And you have to move those gently from the underlying tissue so that the glands or the new clitoris has its own blood supply and will survive. Otherwise, it doesn't have any blood supply in it and it won't survive after surgery. So what I will offer is what would be considered by most people as a one-stage vaginoplasty, meaning that you create all the important structures, so the clitoris, a clitoral hood, inner labia, outer labia, the new position of the urethra, and the vagina in one surgery. But because of the anatomy that you work with, and you saw on that diagram I mentioned before, you can't have the outer labia meet over the clitoris because the skin from the penis goes through there. And if you tried to make them meet, you would disrupt the blood supply, and it's not a safe thing. So that's why there's traditionally been an option of a two-stage surgery. And when we submit this for insurance approval, we will say that it's the first of a planned two-stage operation, knowing that we're planning to create all the important structures at the first operation. But if somebody chooses to have a second surgery to make the outer labia meet over the clitoris, we would also have the opportunity to do some touch-up things, scar vision, you know, correct some asymmetry at that time. The idea is that we've kind of prepared the insurance companies to know that it's not just a cosmetic thing, it's a planned thing due to anatomy. So, you know, we haven't done that yet. I haven't done the surgery yet. Our first surgery is scheduled in April, but we're trying to think ahead and make sure that we're planning, and we try to plan for your benefit with how we deal with insurance companies too. So what do we expect as results? We expect a natural appearing external genitalia. I expect a vaginal depth of about 5 inches, and it may be more than that, but I think that that's a reasonable expectation. And I know that some people say that they can promise, you know, 7 inches of depth. And once you get past about 5 inches, you're getting past the natural place where the support for your graft or your vagina ends. You know, it's only really supported up to the back side of the bladder. After that, you're getting more into the space of inside the abdomen, and I don't think that that's really good support for the graft. You know, there's not as much tissue that's going to allow the new blood vessels to grow into the skin graft, and I don't feel that that's safe, but I know that some people will say that they do that. I am most concerned with good function and safety and not causing injuries or problems, and I wouldn't guarantee any more than that. I think what you would expect is based on your anatomy, and you don't always know what the depth of pelvis is before you're doing the surgery. A sensate clitoris. As I mentioned, I have good experience with doing surgery that involves the nerves for the head of the penis, and published information about the surgery shows that if people are able to reach orgasm before surgery, 85 to 90% of people will be able to achieve orgasm after surgery. And as everybody knows, not everything related to orgasm and sexual function is about anatomy. There's a lot that goes on in the brain, and there's more than this just anatomy there, but we want to make sure that we preserve everything that we can, so that that's not a limiting factor. And as I mentioned, I've had really good experience doing that part of the surgery, so I think that I can confidently say I can preserve those nerves very well. I would expect that you should expect that you would need lubrication. It'd be wonderful if you don't. There are some glands that are present in the tissue that may produce some natural lubrication. And there is the idea that just with arousal, there's increased blood flow in the pelvis, and that can cause lubrication. But just as an expectation, you know, there's a reason why there is a whole industry that makes lubrication for sexual purposes for cisgender people. It's just necessary. Even with all the typical parts, people still need lubrication, and I think that that's something you should count on. And I think it's a safety thing as well, because if you have excessive amount of friction, it could potentially pull the skin and have the skin pooch out more. And you know, there's something called prolapse when things are going when they're not supposed to go. They're pooching out when they're not supposed to pooch out. And I think that that's a slight risk if you're not using lubrication. So I would definitely say that that should be your expectation in my recommendation. When does healing stop? You know, the healing process is ongoing. So you know, if you've ever had a scrape and you've had a scab, that it's not something that starts and stops, you know, quickly. It evolves over time. So, you know, we tell people that most of the healing occurs after 6 weeks, and that refers to the strength that a wound has. You get about 80% of your pre-surgery strength in skin or tissue by about 6 weeks after surgery. So that's usually when it's safe to go back to normal activities that kind of stress the area of surgery. But the healing process is ongoing, and after your body lays down new tissue to bridge an incision or bridge a scar, your body goes and continues to remodel that. And that's what the process is called, is remodeling. You start with really thick tissue that's firm and hard, and over time that gradually softens and becomes less firm. So, you know, if you've had a cut somewhere, it starts off, you know, it doesn't look like much, and then it gets red and thicker, and then over time it gets thinner. So really the healing process, you know, is over a year, and it takes a year for everything to stabilize and soften up. You'll see probably most improvement over the first, you know, 6 weeks to 3 months. There'll be a lot of bruising at first. There'll be a lot of swelling. Nothing will have its final appearance, and you shouldn't really judge until about, you know, 3 months afterwards. Now, it will be getting better before then, but you should just try to expect that it's a long healing process. And also, as this surgery rearranges a lot of skin and a lot of tissue, it's a challenge to the skin. It's also a challenge to what's called the lymphatic system. The lymphatic system is the system where fluid that leaks out of your blood vessels is drawn back into the body. And when you rearrange skin like this, that's a challenge for that system as well as the blood system. And it can take a while for all that swelling to go away, even more than just, you know, the swelling that happens in, you know, routine, you know, cut and close. This is something that takes a while to resolve. So just trying to set expectations for healing there. I'll plan on people staying about 5 to 7 days in the hospital. And most of the time is boring, it's on bed rest, and that's not any fun. I mean, you're just stuck in bed, you can't get up. And the reason for that is, again, the skin grafts. When you take skin, disconnect from its blood supply, and push it up against a raw surface and ask new blood vessels to grow in, if you move, that can disrupt that. So we want you to be stuck in bed, on bed rest, and bored for about 5 to 7 days. It takes about that long for that process to really stabilize. And it's still somewhat fragile after that, but that's the biggest, you know, time frame where it's delicate and vulnerable. There'll be a catheter in the bladder at that time where you won't have to urinate. I mean, that may sound good, but it's really uncomfortable having a catheter in the bladder. A lot of the surgery that I do requires we have a catheter in the bladder so that tissue can heal without urine rushing past a fresh area. Most people would do fine, and we have a dressing or a pack that will hold everything in place while the catheter is in. And then once the catheter and the dressing come out around day 5 after surgery, we'll make sure that you're able to pee well. And if you're able to pee well, then that's great. We won't put a catheter back in. Somewhere around 20 to 30% of people will have temporarily a difficult time urinating. And we think that's because doing the surgery to make the space for the vagina can stretch the nerves that supply the signal for the bladder to contract. So we would want to give that time to recover. It may take another week of having a catheter in the bladder. Hopefully that won't be you, but it's something that statistically we know happens in, you know, 20 to 30% of people. So talking about preparation for surgery, as Amy mentioned, we follow WPATH guidelines, and there are some exceptions, but for the most part, we try to follow the guidelines pretty closely. So that does mean that you will need 2 letters of support from mental health professionals. And as she mentioned also, you know, I can kind of put this on the insurance companies too, because they say that they need those things. They're often trying to follow WPATH guidelines. But I also want to make sure that you've had the time to talk to people who have helped other people through transition. And I know it can sound patronizing to say you need a mental health professional. And it's not saying that you don't know yourself, but trying to make sure that you have, you know, some support and some help from other people as well. I'm probably not articulating that as well as I'd like to, but I do think it's important. Also, 1 year of hormone therapy. Occasionally I see people who are very early in their transition. We want to make sure that you are happy with the results of the hormones and that transition is the right thing for you. I have seen a couple people who have regretted their transition, and they had an orchiectomy and they regretted it, or they started hormones and they regretted the effects. Fortunately, that's rare, but there's good reason to for us to be wanting to encourage patients in that regard, as well as 1 year of living in your role as a woman. So hair removal, you know, we're going to be taking skin that's on the outside of the body and putting it in the vagina. Once that's in place, it's really difficult to get to if you want to remove that hair. I've seen people who had vaginoplasty without removing a lot of hair before, and it's really not a natural look, and you can also have problems with greater chance of discharge or infection and it just being uncomfortable. But we want you to have a natural good result, and I think that taking the time for hair removal ahead of time is although it's difficult and no doubt painful, I think it's worth the time and the effort. So I think it's important to remove the skin from almost all the scrotum, the perineum and that space behind the scrotum, and the base of the penis. In the handout that was on the back table, there's a diagram here, and that's this diagram, my little cartoon here showing the area of interest. And some of the most important parts of this are, you know, the space behind the scrotum or the perineum. Anywhere that is going to be left attached to its natural blood supply, your only chance to remove those hair follicles is with electrolysis or potentially laser before surgery. I often hear questions about the idea of follicle scraping, which is not really an accurate term for it. The idea is that in skin that you're going to use as a graft or skin that you're disconnecting from its blood supply and you're getting rid of the excess part, you can remove the hair follicles from the backside by thinning it out. You can do that only to the portion where you're going to remove the skin and from its blood supply. So the skin of the scrotum, skin of some of the perineum, other parts that you're going to leave connected to its blood supply, you can't do that part. You can't do the so-called follicle scraping. So what about laser versus electrolysis? And I'm no expert, but I do know that electrolysis definitely is considered more painful and takes longer as far as your commitment to, you know, sitting there and having a treatment. It's considered more permanent as well. So, you know, just for what the FDA approves, they approve electrolysis for permanent hair removal, and laser is considered permanent hair reduction. There are some people that may be great candidates for laser. So the ideal candidate for laser is fair skins and dark hair, because the laser uses light absorbed by pigment to heat and kill the hair follicles. And if you have, you know, dark hair but light skin, it's going to be the ideal. And especially people who have already had laser treatments for other parts of the body and know that was effective for them, I think that may be reasonable. Typically, I recommend electrolysis because mostly it's considered to be more permanent. It takes multiple sessions. Now, not every hair is growing at the same time. There's what's called hair cycles, and you know, I don't know the percentage of what hair is growing at an individual time, but even if you have everything in the area treated, at some point, you know, more hair is going to grow that wasn't actively growing at the time you had the treatment. So it takes multiple treatments, and this is something that takes several months, and I know this is the biggest barrier to moving ahead quickly for most people. And as Amy mentioned, it is insurance benefit for a lot of plans, but we're still working out the bugs for that. Moving on to just talking about general health. So we'd like you to be in your best physical shape. So if you've been making New Year's resolutions, get back in shape, you know, now's the time to really put that into effect. The better shape you're in ahead of time, the better your recovery will be, the stronger you'll be, the faster you'll recover your strength. And if you're thinking about weight, you know, there are some people that are too heavy to have the surgery safely. I don't consider this as cosmetic surgery, and there are people in the world that will say there's a limit to your weight you can have the surgery. I don't have a strict cutoff for that, but if that's a concern and we meet, we can talk about that. But I don't think that's a problem for the vast majority of people that I've seen. Over the last year, I've seen more than 100 people who are interested in at least talking about vaginoplasty. And out of those people, I've seen maybe two who I thought were too heavy to have surgery now. So that's not a concern for most people. If you have diabetes, you really want that to be well controlled. Diabetes, if it's not well controlled, leads to poor wound healing and poor healing after surgery, and a greater risk of infection, both in the bladder and the area of the surgery. So you really want to have your diabetes under good control. And really important for me and for a lot of surgeons is that you don't use any nicotine or tobacco. And I say specifically nicotine because that's really the biggest thing. And smoking anything, whether it's tobacco or marijuana, you have some, you know, carbon monoxide from inhaling that smoke, and that's not good for healing. But really what I'm most concerned about is nicotine. Nicotine is a very powerful blood vessel constrictor, and it means that you don't get good blood flow to the areas after surgery and you won't heal as well. So there are some surgeries I do where I don't make a big deal of it because it just isn't quite as important. But I think it's super important here. You're really challenging the blood supply to the skin that you're rearranging, and anytime you have skin that you're using as a graft, that really depends on good blood flow to the skin to survive. And I think it's important enough that I would say we should, you know, if you have surgery scheduled and you can't quit smoking, by all means, please let me know. We'll reschedule. We don't want to do your surgery if you're using nicotine. Sometimes I slip and say smoking because that's kind of the most common thing. But now, even with e-cigarettes and gum and patches and all those other nicotine products, those are all bad for healing after surgery. And what's the data about that? So there's actually good data, and a lot of this comes from the plastic surgery medical literature. And one thing that I found was really interesting was when they're doing facelifts, you know, they really challenge the blood supply of the skin and the face. And when people were smoking, there was more than 10-time increased risk of that skin dying, not just not healing well, that skin dying. And it's a big deal. I think it's really important. Just a single cigarette on one day can decrease the flow of blood to a wound by 40%. And when you're talking about a graft, it really increases your risk of the graft not surviving. And I think it's so important that I put this slide with the references and the scary skull and the cigarettes, which I really like that. But I think it's important enough. And I mentioned here that I think we should talk about having quit smoking at least 4 weeks before surgery. You know, you can argue about what's the medical data for that, and there's not really great data on what the time frame is, but people are pretty consistent about recommending at least 4 weeks. We can often recommend medications that can help. So there's two medications that can help with quitting smoking, and I am comfortable prescribing one of those, but most PCPs are comfortable prescribing both of those if you want that and you need that. I think it's important enough that I am testing for nicotine products in all people, and I do this for my surgery for cisgender people as well, in those surgeries that I think it matters. So it's not something that's new in how I think about things. I've been a big I've been really concerned about smoking for all the surgeries I do where I think that's important. I'm talking a little bit about physical therapy. Most people will think about physical therapists as people that help you recover your strength after you break a leg or break a knee or have knee surgery or some sort of joint replacement. But there's another type of physical therapist specialist that focuses on what's called the pelvic floor. The pelvic floor is this cradle of muscles that support the organs in the pelvis and kind of cover all the openings in the bones. And those muscles are important here because there's no space for the vagina at present in the anatomy, and we're going to be separating these muscles, putting the new skin for the vagina in that space, and then we're asking you to dilate. Now, the body's natural tendency in healing is to contract, and these muscles naturally want to squeeze to support the organs in the pelvis. So when you're trying to do the dilation after surgery, you're already sore, you naturally tighten up your pelvic muscles when you anticipate pain or you have stimulation or pain. And so I think that it could be very beneficial to meet with somebody that can teach you about those muscles, how to recognize those muscles, how to relax those muscles, and those things are going to be helpful in maximizing your chance of success with dilation afterwards. When I saw people who had vaginoplasty after surgery, the biggest conversation was, how are you doing with the dilation? Is it going well? And people were routinely, uncomfortable at best with it. And it's physically uncomfortable. It's physically difficult. So anything that we can do that's helpful for that, I think is good. So as part of the process, when we submit a surgery request, I submit a referral for physical therapy. And we'll want to have you meet with them probably somewhere about a month before surgery so that information is fresh in your mind at the time of surgery. And then after surgery, as you've started dilating and you start figuring out how that works or doesn't work for you, we're going to make another appointment for you to meet with them to kind of, touch up and give you more advice. Sandy Gallagher is the physical therapist that I've worked with since I've been here when people needed a physical therapist for pelvic floor. And when we started making plans to start this program, I reached out to her and asked if she wanted to be involved or she had experience. And she was very enthusiastic about knowing that this was important. And she was here today, but unfortunately she had a family health issue and had to leave and she couldn't be here. I have a few slides of hers that I'll unfortunately butcher as I try to talk about them. But they're a big part of our program, and I think they're going to make things much more likely to be successful. So this is just a picture showing the view of the pelvis from the outside with the muscles in place. And all these things, these are all muscles drawn here. And you can see there's not a space, and this area that is shown in the yellow arc here is where we make the opening of those pelvic muscles to place the vagina. And then this is the same diagram from before, just showing how deep that goes and where that is. Now the point is, there's a big bunch of muscles here, and I think it's really helpful to learn how to perceive those muscles, know when you're contracting them, know what makes them contract, and know how to help them relax as much as possible. And also, when you're making that space between that pelvic muscle support, you do have a chance of making the control of urine less reliable. So genetic females have less support for their continence structure than genetic males, and we're changing anatomy to more closely matched genetic females, so you have a greater chance of what we call stress incontinence, or less ability to resist urine under high pressure than you will have had before surgery. And that is not something that's commonly talked about or recognized. I'm aware of one medical publication that says that that can happen as much as 10% of people. These physical therapists are also the people that can teach you how to strengthen those muscles and hopefully make that not as big of a problem if that is a problem. So this is one of Sandy's slides, and I'll just kind of rush through these because I'm going to butcher them, I'm afraid. She has over 30 years of experience as a physical therapist and is a specialist of the function of muscles, especially as it affects pain and sexual function. She works very commonly with women in the Women's Health Center here, and also in cancer therapy. So common problems that they see are what's called vaginismus or spasm of the vaginal muscles. They also work with people with chronic pelvic pain, both men and women, and people who've had prostatectomy and have leakage of urine after prostate surgery because those control muscles have been weakened. So she's also helpful in teaching about how to hold urine and how to help better empty urine, and also bowel function. This is an important thing as well, and they want to make sure that you're having normal bowel movements without straining. That's important for healing as well. And then really, this is all about helping you dilate successfully. So they want to help you prepare by helping you find what is a relaxed position, making sure that you know that you want to have access to a place that's private for this and is as relaxing as possible, and physically support the legs so that you're not going to be successful with your legs out straight. You need to put your body in a position where it makes it optimal. But I'm unfortunately not able to provide the same amount of detail as the physical therapist would, so I'm going to move on to what I know better. So this is a set of the dilators made by the Sole Source company. It's a company that started in Oregon, and it's used by many surgeons that do vaginoplasty. And we plan on providing a set of dilators after surgery for you. So it's not something you have to go out and purchase. We'll make sure we think that's something that's so important. We'll make sure that you have it. It's not something you have to go out and find. Still have a set of those after your surgery. And we want to be there and help and be present while you do the first dilation, make sure that's successful, and then we'll have more support for you, again, with the physical therapy and with our office as well. We'll have written instructions when you leave the hospital, and as most people recommend, we will probably recommend that you do this 3 times a day at first. I've seen people recommend 4 times a day, and I don't think it's possible to live a normal life with trying to do something 4 times a day. It's challenging enough 3 times a day, but that's waking up early, when you get home, and then before you go to bed. That's somewhat reasonable, I think. It'll probably be like that for the first 3 months after surgery, and then gradually become less, hopefully. And we'll have written instructions for that, and have more details as you go along. It may need to be life-term, or it may need to be lifelong. So we're making a space where there's not a space, and the body's natural way of healing is to contract. If you've ever had a scrape on your hand or your knee, it starts off large and then gradually gets smaller. That's your body contracting that area. The same thing happens here. It's not a space that is maintained in the body naturally, so you kind of have to trick your body during healing to keep that space open. And some people may need to do dilation, although hopefully infrequently, it may be something that's lifelong. It's a difficult surgery to recover from. It's a lot of changes to the body. It's a lot of changes in your life. And it's just a physically difficult surgery to recover from. You'll have the frequent dilation needs, and it can be difficult to walk. So this is a surgery where there's a lot of tissue changing places between the legs. I know from the other surgeries I do in the same position that This area never gets a chance to rest and to heal without the stress of movement. When you get up and get out of bed, even if you're just going to, you know, across the room or going to the kitchen or the bathroom, you're stressing the area where the surgery was. So it can be sore and it can be difficult to walk, and you shouldn't count on, you know, doing long walks in your recovery or being really very active. I recently saw somebody who I think walks 10 miles a day, and they're asking me how quickly they could get back to that, and I think that's going to be a while. I admire that. But I think you're going to need to, you know, count on taking some time off for that. If you work, it's going to be time off work too. And it's always hard to say, you know, how much time you absolutely need off work. It's very individual. And I would say that a safe guide would be about 6 weeks. And if you have a job that permits you to go back to work sooner, that's wonderful if you feel up for it. But I always suggest that you should try to have some flexibility so that you have the opportunity to go back if you feel up to it. But if you don't feel up to it, you can, you know, take it more slow. It's a big financial stress, you know, especially if you're not able to work. So that's something to keep in mind as you're planning for this. You know, it's helpful to have family, friends, whoever's in your life that can support you, try to line those things up ahead of time. If you're concerned about that, we want to know about that ahead of time. I try to ask everybody when I meet them about your support and who's there to help you, because we know that there's going to be some help that's necessary. Food preparation, cooking, just stuff around the house, pet care, shopping, all those sort of things. It's hard to keep track of all those things. I want to see you a lot in follow-up. Especially as we're starting this program, I want to see people frequently. So you'll be in the hospital about a week. I'll ask you to come back about a week after surgery. And then after that, it's a little bit more flexible, but you'll probably keep stretching that out, you know, by greater time intervals. So, you know, after 1 week, then 2 weeks, and 4 weeks. But at least at 3 month time period, and, you know, at least a year afterwards, I'd like to see how you're doing, see how things look, see how your function is. As a urologist, most of the surgery I do is about function, whether it's sexual function or urinary function. I want to know how your function is. And this is a little bit different for most of the surgeries I do, in that, you know, how things look and appear and making sure they appear natural is very important as well. So I want to, you know, see how things look and also hear from you how things are working and functioning. Everything has a risk, and, you know, this is a surgery just like anything else. Surgery has risks. So, you know, minor things are easy to deal with from my side of things, but it doesn't mean it's not distressing or stressful. Minor skin healing problems with any, you know, big rearrangement of skin in surgery are common. So maybe that there's some slight separation of skin, and it may mean that the scar is a little bit present or a little bit more obvious or for longer. Those are fairly common, but we do a lot of things to try to avoid that. Having a blood clot or a hematoma in the wound is something that can happen. We do things to avoid that by making sure that, you know, we check to make sure all the tissue is not bleeding at the end of surgery. We leave drains around the time of surgery, meaning little surgical tubes that help pull out fluid and blood that might collect in the space of surgery. It's unfortunately common to have infections in the bladder after having a catheter in the bladder. And that's something we deal with fairly often in urology, because a lot of the surgery that we do involves bladder catheters. You know, things to do to avoid that are try to get the catheter out as soon as possible. We don't necessarily keep people on antibiotics for a long period of time, because it doesn't necessarily prevent infections when you have a catheter in place. If you're somebody or know somebody who has had problems with urinary tract infections, you may be aware of, you know, the idea of cranberry extract. I think cranberry extract is a nice thing. It allows you to get the benefits of cranberry, which we think are preventing bacteria from adhering to your tissue and causing infection without getting all the sugar that comes in cranberry cocktail. A little bit of a side divergence there. Major complications are fortunately uncommon with the surgeries I do. Usually we have time to prepare to make sure you're in as good a health as possible. And part of who I am is trying to minimize risk for you and for, you know, how I treat people, avoiding things that make things worse, like smoking. Smoking increases your risk of wound problems, your risk of having, you know, blood clots. And we want to, you know, try to minimize all those things. We will give a blood thinner on the day of surgery to prevent blood clots from forming at the time of surgery, and also afterwards while you're stuck in bed. A rectovaginal fistula, that abnormal connection between the rectum and the new vagina, fortunately, is a very rare problem, and I feel very confident in my ability to do that part of the surgery to avoid that. But it is something that is rarely possible, and it's a big deal. If that happens, oftentimes people have to have what's called a colostomy, a temporary diversion of the bowels. That's not a fun thing for anyone, and we want to do everything we can to avoid that. And most of that's on me. You know, there's not much that you can do to avoid that, but it's on me to do a good job, and I'm confident I can do a good job. Fortunately, there's a low incidence of regret with surgery. You know, the published reports are people regret surgery very, very infrequently afterwards. And it may not be that, you know, only 4% of people have some, you know, thoughts every once in a while, like, did I do the right thing? But people who are actively distressed by the whole process afterwards. One of the meetings I went to, they had a series of, I think, 10 people who regretted surgery and were trying to have surgery to transition back the other way. And it was both sides, both trans women and trans men. And that's what nobody wants that. Everyone wants to avoid that. And part of that is making sure that, you know, we kind of follow, you know, the guidelines of people who've had had the experience before me and before us, where, you know, the social support and the letters of recommendation from mental health providers are helpful. Long-term problems that we wouldn't necessarily consider, you know, immediate complications like loss of vaginal depth, hopefully that can be largely avoided with dilation. And we want to try to make sure that dilation is as comfortable and safe for you as possible. Some asymmetry in healing is common. You know, you don't know how things are going to heal necessarily right at the time of surgery. Sometimes, you know, it looks perfect at surgery and things change after surgery. So it's common for anybody to have a little bit of asymmetry in skin. And as I mentioned, you know, if that's something that's really bothersome after the primary surgery, we do have the opportunity in a second stage to deal with some of those things if that's necessary. Urine spraying is common at first. You know, we're changing where the urine comes out and changing a lot of the things about that, but it's unlikely that's going to be a big problem in the long term. And as I mentioned, urine leakage is a small possibility, but it's probably under-recognized. And of course, this is a huge change. You know, everything is going to feel different. What feels good now is going to be different after your anatomy changes. So, you know, take some time to, you know, relearn what feels good and what feels pleasurable, and relearn, you know, your body and yourself. And just as a reminder, healing continues for, you know, really a year after surgery. You know, most of it, you know, the strength is there by 6 weeks, but, you know, swelling and everything is continued, and, you know, by 3 months you hopefully have an idea of what things are going to look like, but things will continue to improve for even a year and beyond. Generally, published rates of satisfaction after surgery is very high, and we have a lot of resources to help, so, you know, hopefully we're setting up a program that is going to help you, you know, achieve what you want and what you need, and we want to help you get there successfully, so. That's all I have.
Thank you so much. We did pass around index cards if you've got questions that you would like Dr. Dugi to answer. Kareth, Vic, Jay, if you could be on the ends of the aisles, and people can pass their questions on to you. And we thank the folks who submitted questions in advance, and we'll start with those questions first as you're submitting your questions on your index cards. If you do have to leave early, we do appreciate you completing an evaluation form. Thank you.
So a few questions we got ahead of time, and I'll do my best to answer these. I think a lot of things are probably better, kind of face-to-face in about some of these questions, but is there a way to bill OHP for genital electrolysis? I think that is coming. I think we have the questions of that being worked out soon, but I still
I can say one more thing.
Okay, please.
OHP does cover pre-surgical site electrolysis, and there are now the codes available for the electrologist to get paneled with insurance companies. If any electrologist is here and has questions about those codes, I'm happy to answer those for you today. Hi, Mary Beth. And right now, there are some health plans that are really trying to fast-track getting that credentialing done, so I'm happy to tell you which ones those are for the providers in the room. And I expect that the rest of the health plans will fall in line with that. There's a meeting coming up at the state on March 14th to look at this alignment and get all of the Medicaid health plans around the state aligned around this to make this move much more smoothly. For Medicare, this is considered considered a pre-surgical requirement that will meet medical necessity. And for most private plans, either they're employer-based plans or through the marketplace, that too should cover as pre-surgical site. It will require a prior authorization, which Dr. Dugi's office will process for you. Anyone having some obstacles with the electrolysis, you're welcome to email me at transhealth@ohsu.edu, and I can work with you around that.
Hopefully these other questions I can do a better job with. Do I need a doctor's note to be out for recovery? We will be happy to provide that, and that's a routine part of how we help people after surgeries. We provide documentation and FMLA, all that sort of stuff that you need for work after surgery. Is it possible to have the surgery if I had an inguinal hernia? Yes, but I don't think that that's any real concern. People often ask as well, does orchiectomy ahead of time affect anything? There are some people that think that that's a problem. I don't, and the surgeons that I learned from don't think that that's a problem either. Is it possible to get this operation if I have herpes or other infectious problems? It's not a problem. We don't treat people any differently. Herpes, HIV, hepatitis, it's all the same. It doesn't prevent anybody from having surgery. As long as it's well controlled and you're healthy, then that doesn't matter at all. We do the same thing regardless. Do I have any pictures of successful surgeries? No, I don't have any successful surgeries yet. I haven't done the surgery yet. I hope I was at least reasonably clear about that. I'm to the point where we're offering our first surgery. Our first surgery will be done very soon in April. And by the time, if I haven't seen you before and you want to see me, hopefully by the time you'd be ready for surgery or closer to the time of scheduling that, we'll have pictures of people's results that we can hopefully share with you. But I don't have that at this time. Do you perform labiaplasty? Now, coming as a question coming from somebody in email, I don't know exactly what they mean to ask about that. Oftentimes, labiaplasty is the term used for the second stage surgery after the primary vaginoplasty to make the labia minora. My plan is to do a surgery that's considered a one stage, so you make all those important structures at the first time. We would probably call it a labiaplasty at the second stage if we were going to make the outer labia come over the clitoris. So yes, but my plan is to do what would consider be a one-stage surgery. I kind of mentioned where I'd visited. I spent 6 weeks in the last year traveling to learn from other surgeons doing this, two trips to Europe and an additional two trips here in the United States. I'm going to be a little bit coy about that in the sense that I don't want to I'm not going to mention the name of who I visited in the United States because I don't want you to think that I trained with that person extensively, and that person probably wouldn't want me to say that I had trained with that person anyway. So I hate being mysterious about it, but I don't want to complicate, you know, future relationship there. So I hopefully have made the case that I have good training and background, and my surgical experience is a good place to start with this, and I've done a diligent job of trying to learn the surgery. I tend to be a conservative surgeon in the sense that I don't want to take risks for people or put people at risk, and I wouldn't offer a surgery if I didn't think I could do a good job. That doesn't necessarily mean anything to you hearing that, but I'm very sincere about that. And then a question about SRS without vaginoplasty. I respect people's decisions, and the part of the surgery to create the vagina is one of the more risky parts of the surgery. It's also the part that leads to the most difficulty in recovery. I recognize that, and I recognize that that's not necessarily right for everybody. And I would say, let's talk about that on an individual basis. And I think we can work with that. I don't want to advertise anything else, but I'll just kind of leave it at that. How will you handle the increased workload on top of your current surgeries? That's an excellent question and something I've been actively dealing with. So one example is until January of this year, I spent one day a week at the Veterans Hospital. And I love it. I think I love working with our vets. It's a great place to work, but I didn't have a natural place to gain more time. And so I've gone from 4 days a week, or 4 days a month there, to 1 day a month. So there's three extra days a month. And we're looking for ways to make my surgeries and clinical schedule just more efficient and get more operating time. So that's an active process. At the present, we have a limited number of people who are ready for surgery, so they're able to work into our kind of routine schedule as it is. But as more people become ready, we'll have to adjust to that. And you know, we hope to be able to do that and keep waiting times to an acceptable time frame. I don't want to ever have a time when people are waiting ridiculous amounts of time for their surgery. We will continue to work on that, though. Can you please give us examples of any additional contraindications that would prevent a candidate for surgery? Nice, broad, open question. It's hard to just think of things right off the bat. In general, being fit for surgery means that your heart is healthy enough for surgery. You don't have complications of breathing that make you unfit for surgery. Those are all things that are just kind of routine things about surgery. But I don't know that there's much else that's specific to this surgery. I've even seen at least one patient who had a penile amputation who wanted to have vaginoplasty. And unfortunately, with my other experience from other surgeries, I know the anatomy well enough to know that there are some downsides to that. You definitely have some loss of options, but it doesn't preclude it. So I would generally say that, on an individual basis, there's not probably a lot other than just general health. I know that's kind of vague. I'll try. The questions are great for anonymous, the cards are great for anonymous questions, but once we're done with that, if we want to open it up to anyone who has questions they want to ask directly, that's okay too. What if someone has had their prostate removed? If the space closes because of, okay, that's a separate question. So what if someone has had the prostate removed? So that would definitely make the dissection to make the vagina more difficult. Talking to other surgeons, the people that I've learned from, that is fortunately a rare instance, and it's not something that even very experienced surgeons doing vaginoplasty have come in contact with a lot. I would say that it's a lot more risky. That space is more difficult to dissect. You have a greater risk of injury to the rectum, and you have an even greater risk of worsening control of urine afterwards. After the prostate's removed, you have some risk of urine leakage after that. And when you then further disrupt the support for the continence mechanisms, you have a greater risk of incontinence. I wouldn't say it's impossible, but it's definitely more risky. And that would definitely be something we talk about together at length. If the space closes because of lack of dilation, will you have any issues with urinating? I don't think so. The opening to the urethra will be outside of the vagina, and the urethra doesn't pass through that space of the vagina. So if that narrows, it's unlikely that there would be really any effects on the urination. Does the area where the graft is added to lengthen the vagina have issues with stricture from scar tissue? Grafts, more so than tissue with its own blood supply, have a risk of contracting. And that's one of the reasons why people end up needing to dilate, because the graft will tend to contract. When you take what's called a full thickness graft, meaning all the levels of the skin, there's less risk of it contracting than if you take what's called a split thickness skin, or kind of shaving the outside of the skin. You may have heard about that for people who've had burns. So this is more of a full thickness graft, so the skin has less chance of contracting than thinner skin, but there's still a chance of that, and that's why the dilation is something that's going to be going on long term. My experience with skin grafts is that by a year, they have been as soft as you're going to be. Usually by about 6 months, they've softened up quite a bit. But during the first 3 months and even 6 months, they're thicker. They're not as flexible or soft. But that really improves really between 6 months and a year. And by after a year, it's usually pretty good. Next question, why does the prostate gland need to remain and our standard digital exam and blood test needed? Is that an issue with insurance? Those are really good questions and somewhat controversial. So the prostate isn't removed mostly because there's a lot of risk with removing the prostate. When you take out the prostate for cancer purposes, you're removing the whole gland itself. There's other versions of prostate surgery where the prostate is enlarged and it causes difficulty urinating and you don't necessarily remove the entire prostate. But removing the entire prostate, particularly for cancer, you risk damage to the nerves that cause erection. That's not as much of a concern as the structures and the nerves that are important for continence or control of urine. So that's really a big risk of removing the prostate. Also, you have a lot more bleeding with that surgery, and it's just not considered to be necessary. It's more disruptive, it's more invasive, so it's not something that's usually done. Now, what about the prostate afterwards? Now, how would you examine that? So, right now the prostate is right behind the rectum, and by making the vagina, you move it away from the rectum. So, right now to have a prostate exam for people with prostates, the normal thing is a finger in the rectum to feel the prostate. After vaginoplasty, that wouldn't work. You'd have to have an exam through the vagina with the finger to feel the prostate. As a urologist, I know that whole issue is very controversy, even for cis men who are in the range of or the greatest risk of prostate cancer. We think that people who are on estrogen have a much lower risk of prostate cancer, but it's not non-zero. I mean, it's not zero risk. And as I mentioned before, there's no research that really guides us on what to do. And as far as the insurance goes, no doubt there are some issues with getting insurance to pay for PSA tests when your rest of your medical records show you're a woman. But that's something that can probably be fought and argued if that's necessary. You may be aware that PSA is extremely controversial over the last 5 years or so. It's taken a big hit in its popularity because there's something called the U.S. Preventive Task Force that reviewed some literature and found that they didn't think that it was helpful in saving lives for prostate cancer. Now, most urologists would argue with that, but the point is it's controversial and there's no clear answer for that.
Can I answer a few while you look at these?
Okay. There is a question here. What do you look for in letters from mental health professionals? What should I ask my therapist to write about? I would be happy to be a resource for any of your mental health professionals and send them a template and some guidelines for what they can include in their letter writing. And I've probably spoken directly with maybe 15 or 20 therapists and reviewed their letters so that I could give them some feedback about what I think not only will work for the clinic, but what will work for the insurance company. So please use me as a resource for that. There's a question here about how do we get various private insurance plans to cover surgery, and I'll say a couple of things. One is that the Oregon Insurance Division released a bulletin, I think it was in 2014 or 2013, that suggested that all plans should be providing this service and not discriminate based on gender identity. Not all insurance plans are regulated by the Oregon Insurance Division, but for those that are, I'm happy to send you that legal bulletin so that you can use that in your advocacy work. There's also a notice of proposed rulemaking through Health and Human Services at the federal level that would also prohibit discrimination based on gender identity or expression. And if that one moves forward, that will have an impact on virtually every plan. So we hope that that one will be successful. There is advocacy work that can be done if your insurance plan doesn't cover it because you have an employer-based plan that does not have an inclusive benefit. I've experienced a range of situations, one of which included an employee who was with a company that didn't include the benefit because it never crossed their mind. And once it was brought to their attention, they were extremely responsive and actually made plans so that that particular employee could have their benefits. So it really ranges, and I'm happy to work with you on what advocacy measures are available to get engaged in now. There's a question about, is there laser treatment available with insurance? And I would say that's going to vary insurance by insurance. My hunch is that most plans will say that electrolysis is what is FDA approved for permanent hair removal and that they will likely be less willing to cover the laser hair removal. But I will tell you with Medicaid, with OHP, we have a meeting coming up next week where we'll be presenting advocacy for the inclusion of laser hair removal for the Medicaid plan, so we should know about that outcome next week. I will begin answering these questions, and then I'm going to pass them on to Dr. Dugi to finish. Looks like there's some similarity between some of these questions. And this is in regards to people who choose not to be on hormones. Can they still seek and get approved for vaginoplasty? And I would say that will be very insurance dependent in terms of what your plan requires. And I would say for most plans, if there is a contraindication for the hormone use, that would be the exception. And it's about how that contraindication is demonstrated, both either medical contraindication or psychological contraindication. Most insurance plans don't have any concept of gender fluidity and the non-binary experience, not even our Medicaid plans. So a lot of work needs to be done to educate the health insurance industry about that so that these requirements are not so firm. But from an insurance standpoint, I would say that's going to be a little bit of a difficult battle, but one that I would be happy to work with you around advocacy for. And in terms of your clinical practice, I'll defer to you to answer that piece.
So surgery in people that don't identify on the gender binary is one of the biggest areas of, I guess, discussion, interest, and controversy among surgeons. And having been to a couple of different meetings and heard people speak, I don't know that there's a clear answer on that. I will say that personally, I want to really respect people's autonomy and work with you whatever way possible. And I'm continuing to learn, obviously. I won't say no, but I don't know that I have a clear answer for what might not be a very specific question. But I will say that I try to respect people's autonomy and their body in every way that I can. I think this is another question about inguinal hernia. I don't think an inguinal hernia in general is a problem. That's not something that is likely to really interfere with the surgery. How long do I wait before I can move 50-pound boxes at work? Good for you. I would say probably a good 6 weeks would be, you know, my recommendation for that. Is there any difference in outcomes depending on whether you have circumcised or uncircumcised penis? The good thing is, you know, circumcised or uncircumcised, there's more skin, and I think it's just only better. You know, people who are circumcised, there's less skin, but I don't think that's really a problem for most people. Uncircumcised, it's actually better for this surgery because there's more skin to use. Does one have to discontinue hormones before surgery? I would say yes to discontinuing estrogen, and I will ask people to stop estrogen for 2 weeks before surgery. Again, I'll admit that's something that doesn't have necessarily a lot of medical research support, but we do know that taking estrogen increases your risk of forming blood clots. There's a lot about this surgery that increases your risk of forming blood clots. Being in the position that you'll be in for the surgery for a long period of time, that's a risk. Surgery around the pelvis is a risk. Being immobile after surgery or being stuck in bed rest, that's a risk for blood clots. So we want to do the things that we can to try to limit those risks. So the 2 weeks before surgery, we'll ask you to stop estrogen, and you can start that when you leave the hospital. Hopefully it'll be enough comforting to know that you're getting this surgery to deal with the stress of not having the hormones. Spironolactone, you can continue to take that for the 2 weeks before surgery, and then you won't need it after surgery because the testicles go away. Is recovery faster or easier if one avoids additional grafts for vaginal depth? I don't know that recovery would be easier or faster, but there's certainly, you know, less risk of, you know, things narrowing afterwards. It all depends on, I think, how much you have and what's important to you. You know, some people tell me that vaginal depth is very important, and other people say that it's not as important. And I'll listen to you and respect your thoughts there. I don't think it really changes the need for dilation, because part of the dilation is keeping the space between the muscles open. So I think that's going to be a continued need. But it definitely makes recovery. Well, you won't have the risk of the graft not taking, but otherwise, I don't think it changes too much. And where do follow-up visits happen? Our offices in urology are here on the 10th floor of this building, and that's where I would plan for people to follow up. That's all the questions I have here.
Were there any more cards that were passed around for questions? Okay. Do you want to field any more questions?
If anybody wants to ask questions in public now, that's great. If you want to come up and talk to me afterwards, that's okay too. I'll hang out for a while. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just wondering. It's going to be a long time on the hair removal. Does it make sense to have
it? It's completely up to you. So she asked if it's going to be a long time before you can have SRS or vaginoplasty. Does it make sense to have an orchiectomy first? And that's a very individual decision. It's really, you know, are you bothered by having the testicles enough to have the surgery separately? You know, the benefit is, you know, you don't have to take spironolactone. If it's helpful to be rid of the testicles earlier, I'm more than happy to do that. I don't think there's a big risk of that, doing it separately. I know there are particularly Thai surgeons that say that you shouldn't have orchiectomy first if you're going to have vaginoplasty. The people I learned from don't think that that's a problem. And my understanding of anatomy in the surgery, I don't think that that's a problem. But it is an extra anesthetic. It is an extra time where you're recovering, although the recovery for orchiectomy is a lot easier than for vaginoplasty. So I would say that very much depends on how you feel about things. And I'm open to help with either one of those processes. Other questions?
I have a question and a comment.
Okay.
Question is, you mentioned meeting with OHP to discuss about colossus and the coverage that mm-hmm. be on March 14th. Mm-hmm. Do you have any more particulars about that?
So there are two meetings coming up. One is on March 10th, which is the Health Evidence Review Commission, which is what determines what is on the prioritized list for Medicaid. That meeting on March 10th is to advocate for the inclusion of laser hair removal as part of the benefit for gender dysphoria. The other piece that we'll be advocating for on March 10th is to extend the permitted duration of electrolysis sessions allowed on any given day, because right now the limit is 30 minutes. The meeting on March 14th is basically, it's a quality improvement coordinator meeting from all coordinated care organizations or health plans across the state. And that meeting is to provide an overview of the HERC guidelines for the treatment of gender dysphoria and to bring greater alignment across all of the health plans across the state about what the current benefit is, and also bring foundational knowledge to the health plan administrators and quality improvement coordinators about gender dysphoria and the treatment for it.
Where would I be able to get information about
The HERC meeting is open to the public. The meeting on March 14th is a closed session. I will say, though, that HERC meeting on March 10th, the goal is, given the history we've had at advocacy at those prior sessions, we're attempting to keep it very brief and succinct and maintain a relatively low profile at that event by not having presence of additional public, because it draws attention in ways that are not always beneficial for our advocacy efforts. But I'm happy to give information about those sessions, point you in the direction of the website so you can see what's on their agenda. Those minutes are open to the public, and all of the testimony that we've been gathering and submitting in writing should be available on that website. So you can ask me directly and I can provide that to you.
And my comment was about orchiectomies. While certainly it's an option, and as an electrologist, I can work with either, but it's easier and it doesn't take as long if you do not have it, simply because there's support structure that's there, and so it's not as difficult to get a good stretch to perform the insertion, to perform electrolysis, and if that support structure is there, then there's not as much worry about going from one layer of skin into the other layer of skin when you're performing the insertion, and there's not as much concern about building up lye in between the layers. So it can be done either way, but I know that personally I'm much slower if somebody's had an orchiectomy. So
did everybody hear her? Okay. And yeah, it makes sense to me if you can have one surgery, that makes more sense. But if you need the orchiectomy before then, by all means, I'm happy to help.
Yeah, it can be done without. It's just be aware that it takes longer.
So if you have like a less active job, like a secretarial type of job, do you think you'd be able to go back to work at a shorter time? Like not.
Most likely. And that's where I think, you know, having some flexibility and going back to work is really helpful. So if you can tell them, well, I'd like to try to come back early and I may be too tired. So one thing that happens after, you know, surgery is that, you know, you may feel good early, but you tire out quickly. Plus,